Hey church, welcome to the Packed Bible Podcast with Glenn Power, a weekly podcast to help guide and encourage you as you read through the Bible this fall. So grab the Bible reading plan from the show notes and let's jump in.
I heard faith's gone out of fashion, at least according to my old friends. Guess I've never been one to keep up with the modern trends, cause maybe I'm out of style. Whether or not that's true, when I look at the stars, all I see is you.
All right, we are on with the Radiant Pack Bible Podcast, affectionately known as the RPBP. And we are getting to the end of our podcast season. So we're getting to the end of the pack season. And these packs, these podcasts were originally meant to help the people in the packs and just be kind of a fun companion as people are reading the Bible together. So we are about the end of our season here. Today we are going to have a guest, Steve McClain, the man, the myth, the legend. you can tell by his low octave voice that he is much more manly than I am.
Oh, yeah.
Yep, see?
No doubt.
It's kind of like a Johnny Cash.
Yeah.
The Johnny Cash voice.
Well, yeah.
You and Forrest, I'm envious.
Yeah, it's intimidating, especially with phone solicitation.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so a few podcasts ago, we had some young adults for a couple episodes, and then for a couple episodes, we had some middle schoolers. And I thought it'd be cool to end our season with some wisdom, some gray-haired wisdom. Does that offend you to be the gray-haired wisdom?
No, but actually, when my hair turns gray, it thinks it's Miller time and it just leaves. So,
oh man,
yeah, you'll notice that I still have color.
Yeah,
but I have less of it.
Yeah, is that real? Is that real color?
Yeah.
Am I? Wow. So I have more gray hair than you.
Yes.
Wow.
In your beard as well.
Oh my gosh! So your voice is lower and you have less gray hair.
Do you want to just call me Butch?
Oh my gosh. I asked Steve McClain. I've known Steve off and on for, I guess, my whole life because
yeah, since we were a young boy.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess we started going to, Grace Community when I was probably 8 or 9. And I think you guys were already attending or attending around the same time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So we went to church together and I knew the McClains and I remember you playing guitar at Grace a lot. And I remember your kids. Yeah. I remember both of them. And so long history with Steve and it's been kind of a cool reconnection here at Radiant. And I appreciate your wisdom. Steve has a lot of wisdom to offer. Steve has been through a lot in his life and he still loves Jesus. He still loves the
Absolutely.
Bible.
Absolutely.
Yes. And that's kind of what I wanted to just glean from a little bit today. And Steve is also a master storyteller. And that may come out a little bit.
Yeah.
We might need to rein it in if the stories get too crazy.
I know. I'm called the man of 1,000 stories. And I said, well, that's just volume one.
Yeah. I remember even more recently, a few years ago, going to your house. And I was probably there for 2 hours. And it just seemed like 10 minutes because you were just telling these stories and I was so just drawn into these stories. So you definitely have a gift with telling stories.
I think I lured you with lunch.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
Yep. Steve's here and I'm going to ask him some questions. So let's start off light. What's something that most people don't know about Steve McClain?
It goes back to my early youth. I was a little bit of trouble for my mom.
Okay. It's not surprising.
Yeah, she had to keep a close eye. I remember when she would go next door to visit with her best friend, I would literally climb out of the crib just so I could get in trouble. And,
wow.
I did. But at age four, one of my favorite things was when the family would drive down to Palm Desert. And this was 1955.
Okay.
Yeah. And, my Aunt Kitty, or Catherine Pritzlov, had this gorgeous home right near the Shadow Mountain Country Club. And so, my dad would go play golf. My mom would go visit my uncle and aunt. And, and Kitty didn't keep a close eye on me.
Mm-hmm.
So, I was supposed to be taking a nap, and I didn't really enjoy napping. I do now.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Me too.
So, I snuck out of the house.
Okay. How old were you?
Four.
Okay.
And I was, intrigued by this house, Kitty cornered Kitty's house.
Mm-hmm.
And it was all white. The roof was covered in white little rocks, and the entire yard, front, back, was all quartz.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't any other color anywhere on the house. And I thought, this is, I'm going to go explore this place.
Mm-hmm.
So, I wandered in the front yard, and I picked up rocks. By four, I'd learned that rock throwing can be an enjoyable sport. And you can do it individually,
Uh-huh.
I wandered into the backyard because the house had no fence, and I was alarmed that the family had a pool in the shape of a 10-gallon hat, and I don't mean horizontally, it was vertically a 10-gallon hat.
Wow.
With the top cut off, and the side walls were, I would say, probably 12 mm-hmm. feet high.
Yeah.
And you had to dive into the brim of the hat to get into the pool. And I think the idea was having that 10-gallon thing kept some shade on it.
Okay.
And Palm Desert does get warm.
Yeah.
And so I thought, all these rocks and an empty pool, what a shame.
Uh-oh.
Let's see. So I start picking up rocks, and the first couple I hit the sidewalls made a loud noise,
Yep.
I don't know if it was made of fiberglass or plastic or what.
Yeah.
And then I finally figured out it wasn't the distance, it was the height. So I kind of mastered it, and I had, like five or six in a row, and I'm cheering myself on. You're nailing it, Steve.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden the bathroom window slides open, and this older gentleman goes, "Hey, kid, what are you doing?" Now, I've got, my hands are full of rocks.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. That was always my, kind of my Steve Martin, I forgot.
Uh-huh.
I dropped the rocks.
Yeah.
And he says, "Hey, come out to the front of the house. I want to meet you." Okay. So I walk out, and this guy walks out, and he's all in white, beautiful white suit, white shirt, white trousers, white boots, and brilliantly white hair. And he walks up to me with a huge box full of suckers.
Oh.
And I'm...
Took a turn, surprising turn here.
Because he was going to elicit some responses from me, and candy's a good way to do that, mm-hmm. with a four-year-old.
I thought he was going to wallop you. that's a good 1950s word, too, huh? Wallop?
Yeah, yeah. Smackdown. Anyways, I'm noticing that this guy really looks familiar to me.
Okay.
And he says, "What's your name?" And I said, "Stevie." And he goes, "Well, Stevie, where do you live?" And I said, "Well, I live right across the street at my Aunt Kitty's house." And he goes, "Oh, Kitty, that's your aunt." "Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, do you promise never to throw rocks in my 10-gallon hat pool?" And I said, "Absolutely." Of course, it did cost him a whole handful of suckers. I think I took all the green ones.
Okay.
Yeah. And so I go back, and I'm taking my nap, you know, to cover my tracks or my trail.
Mm-hmm.
And when I wake up, I walk into the living room, and my Aunt Kitty is sitting there with Gabby Hayes. And Gabby Hayes is in his full Western regalia. You know, the vest, wearing a six shooter too.
Okay.
The chaps, the whole that beard, sort of like yours.
Okay.
And he waves me over, and he goes, "I understand your name is Stevie." And I said, "Yes."
Should I know who Gabby Hayes is?
Gabby Hayes was in films with a gentleman named William Boyd.
Okay.
But his theater name was Hopalong Cassidy, and that's who I was throwing rocks in Hopalong Cassidy's pool. And if you don't remember Hopalong Cassidy, for years and years, his head and or body was on the side of all the producers' milk cartons.
Oh, okay.
So he was very famous.
I think this will have special meaning to those who were born before 1970 or 1960.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, a lot of...
This is what I love about these podcasts. This is going to be especially meaningful. We had another podcast where somebody was playing chess on their phone, and we all made fun of them because that seemed like a real, like, Gen Z younger thing to do. But... So he's sort of a celebrity, this person.
Well, yes.
Yeah, for he was a real celebrity, yeah.
The two of them were extremely famous, making cowboy films in the, you know, late 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
And he was Hoppy, and we became friends later in life, and, you know, clear until he passed away, and then friends with his wife.
Yeah.
Someday I'll tell you an exciting story about her, too.
Okay, I can't wait.
All right.
Hey,
Gabby Hayes made me swear and put his hand on that pistol. You know, of course, it was a stage gun, but I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to, you know, no more rocks anywhere. I'm never going to touch a rock again as long as I am in your presence.
Yep. Stevie was reformed. Yep. Steve, were you raised in a Christian family, or did you come to faith later?
Well, my father became a believer during World War II, and as you can possibly imagine, you know, there are no atheists and in holes.
Jeez.
and that's a miracle story in itself. I mean, God literally did something to prove how much he loved my father.
Yeah, and that was before you were born?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was before I was even imagined.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That was 1944.
Okay.
Anyways, so from the time I was one until I was eight, the only church that I attended was in Palm Desert, and my uncle was the pastor, and his wife played the piano, Mary, beautiful woman.
Mm-hmm.
And a gentleman named Dwight D. Eisenhower attended that church with his
really?
Wife. Yeah.
Wow,
yeah.
More celebrities.
So I got to meet...
I do know that name. I know that one.
Yeah, I like Ike. I met him back in the 50s.
Okay.
And a lot of other people, too.
Wow.
Yeah.
Amazing.
So at eight...
What kind of church was it?
Presbyterian.
Okay.
Yeah. At eight, we moved to Altadena, which is adjacent to Pasadena.
Okay.
And my Uncle Warren became the associate pastor at Westminster Presbyterian Church. And it's an exact copy of Westminster Abbey.
Mm.
And it's huge and ornate, held 2,500 people, three balconies. And just one of the stained glass windows would probably be worth more than all the structures on this whole block.
Yeah.
So I started going to church then, and we went almost every week.
Okay.
But that's not where the big, how can I say this, where God literally introduced himself to me.
Yeah. Yeah. How old were you when that happened?
Nine.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's young.
I went to a Baptist church camp, and actually my primary reason for going there was not to study the Bible, but a girl that I was very much enamored by. Mm-hmm. Her name was Pam, blonde, really cute. And, of course, I was madly in love, you know, at nine.
Yeah.
And I heard she was going to the camp. So, I'm going.
Yep. God has used many a Pam to get people into these camps, and then he reveals himself to them.
Well, yeah, I actually more or less led her later in life. But okay. Towards the end of the week at Tockwitz, was the name of it, and there was an altar call. And as a Presbyterian, I'd never heard one before. And this gentleman said, if there's anyone in this room, and there were hundreds of kids in there, and you'd like to be introduced to Jesus as your Savior, you can go out the back door, follow the trail to the top of the hill. There's a chapel there. Go in the chapel, and someone will come in and tell you about Jesus and how you can invite him into your life. And so he talked for a little while. We got down on our knees, and I asked Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. And the moment I did that, everything changed. Mm. I mean, I literally sensed a joy, a different kind of joy than I had ever known. And I couldn't explain it. And so, I think a day or two later they had the closing campfire, and they asked if anyone wanted to give a testimony. And I walked up and I told them, the story and how it was already changing my life and the way I felt about other people, about my family, and especially about God.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fantastic. Before I ask the next question, this is a question that I didn't prepare you with, but just as a fun, maybe short little aside, how did you meet Janet?
Oh, yeah.
Well, that was a smile is on his face.
That was a God thing. Wow. I was going to college at San Diego State. I was working as a waiter at the Hungry Hunter in Mission Valley. And one of these young men who worked in the kitchen named Ralph said, Janet's coming. And I'm like, Ralph, contain yourself. What? Who is Janet? Oh, Janet's my friend. And Ralph was a little different. And aren't we all? And, I was working 3-4 days a week, and every time I saw him, Janet's coming. She's going to be here tomorrow. And I'm like, great. Okay. Thanks, Ralph. I can hardly wait. Mm-hmm. And I am changing into my buckskin outfit in the kitchen, literally. And so, you look like a hunter. You know, the leather tassels and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And she walks in the back door. And I was smitten.
Mm.
And in those days, I did not attach myself to any young woman in a permanent fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Dating was fine. Go to a movie, go out to dinner, whatever. But I walked up to Janet, and I lifted her hand, and I spun her around. And I remember every detail of what she was wearing. And I said, aren't you the cutest thing? And she looked at me like, well, a devil like you is not going to you know.
Wait, this is the first thing you ever said to her?
First thing I said.
You spun her around?
I spun her around and said, aren't you the cutest thing? And she goes, this guy is bad news. I'm staying away from him.
So yeah, wow, Steve. Coming on strong.
Well, yeah, I can't help it. I'm sorry. I said smitten. It was one of those, like in the movie The Godfather. Oh, he was hit by a thunderbolt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, so I was hit by a thunderbolt. And every night that she worked as the hostess, there was a bench across from her station. And I would just sit there. And initially, I was just staring at her and smiling like I did with Pam when I was a little kid.
Yeah, yeah.
All right? You get that smile on your face, and you can't take it off.
Yeah.
And then we just started talking about, our lives and how much fun I had with fishing in the Sierras with my dad. And
yeah.
I was still doing that. And so she got to know me at a different level. So, but I kept telling myself, no, Steve, no. This one's going to change your whole life.
Hmm.
And I was afraid of that. But at the end of 3 weeks, I gave up.
Yeah. You welcomed it. You welcomed the life change.
And I need to say this, but anybody who knows Janet knows, they say, boy, you lucked out. How did that happen? Oh, you are a blessed man.
Yeah.
I married the best person I've ever known in my whole life. And I'm grateful for it every single day.
Yeah.
And she has a heart like nobody else.
Yeah.
And in fact, right now she's taking care of another woman in our church.
Yeah, you're telling me. Yeah.
Yeah. So,
That's awesome, man.
Yep.
Love it. I'm glad I asked. Okay, so this is a Radiant Pack Bible podcast. So I did want to ask, when is a time in your life that the scriptures brought you strength and comfort when nothing else could, and you can just what was going on in your life and what was the scripture that helped you?
Well, I was 38 years old. I went to a health fair at the convention center because Janet was going to be doing a jazzercise thing, and I took the two kids, and Justin was just a toddler, and Ashley was about five, and I wanted to get my cholesterol checked, so I went up, and there was a line of there must have been 50 people in line. And most of them elderly, as I am now. And I was holding on to the kids, and this doctor came out of no place. And now I know who it is. Well, his name's Havard. And he's an oncologist. So he goes, come with me. I'll take you to the front of the line. You can bring your kids with you. And so he did, and I could make the story longer because multiple miracles occurred, but I got a call the very next day from a nurse at the blood center, and she said, are you Mr. McClain? I said, yeah. She goes, are you sitting down? And I was like, oh, my God. Janet had just left with the kids. They're going to tell me she was in a car wreck. And I said, are my wife and kids okay? And she goes, it's not them. It's you. And I said, what do you mean? And she goes, can you get somebody to drive you to the hospital right now? And I'm like, well, why? And she says, well, you have an uncommonly, in fact, deadly level of platelets in your body. Well, I got A's in biology, physiology, morphology, all that. So I knew what cancer was, and I knew what she was talking about.
Yeah.
And so that was it. And by that time, I had been teaching for a number of years already.
Okay.
So I was quite familiar with the word. And there's always been three favorite books of the Bible to me.
Okay.
Genesis, because I'm a history freak. I've read hundreds and hundreds of books on it. Mm. And Isaiah, incredible prophet.
Yeah.
And humble, as you may recall, his first encounter. I am not worthy.
Yeah.
And, God uses hot coal on his lips to say, now you have no guilt.
Yeah.
And so, and there's in chapter 41, it's...
is this Isaiah?
Of Isaiah,
okay.
Yeah. Verse 10, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And so remembering and reading that verse was a comfort. And then they diagnosed me with a disease called thrombocytosis. It's rare. It's incurable. But they can feed you poison every day to kill all of your blood cells.
Okay.
And I had the second worst case in history. So they sent me to Stanford, and they couldn't tell me anything different.
Yeah. And by feed you poison, you mean some strong medication that's really, really bad for your body.
Yeah. It's called hydroxyurea.
Okay.
Do you want to know what that is?
Well, no.
Okay.
I just want to clarify for the people listening,
All right. But I need to tell you this, because I know that you wanted to talk about the word, but the word can come to us not just from the Bible, which of course is like an entire love letter to all mankind, and a story of Jesus from beginning to end.
Mm-hmm.
And after staying at home for 2 weeks, because they told me don't travel, and I covered the whole Western U.S., and I just said, I can't sit at home and wait for, to die. So I told Janet, I'm gonna take off tomorrow morning. I'm going to do the high desert, L.A., the coast, all the way to Paso Robles, and then I'll come home. So I'll be gone most of the week. And she didn't want me to go, but I was determined. I had to get out of the house. So from the moment I woke up, I started praying. I'm praying in the shower. I'm praying getting dressed. I'm praying getting in the car. I'm praying driving to Bakersfield. And as I turn onto Highway 58 going east to go to the high desert, in the middle of my prayer, God's voice came in like a beautiful, gentle thunder.
Mm-hmm.
And it immediately caught my attention. And he said, Stephen, do not be afraid. I love you. I want you to be with me, but I'm not going to take you now. That was 35 years ago. And I'm the longest survivor in history.
Wow.
And there you go. And I'm still taking that fabulous medicine 3 times a week.
Wow. Okay. Yeah.
So that amazing. The word can come to you.
For sure.
From Jesus directly.
For sure.
Or a friend can share it with you.
Yeah.
And the Holy Spirit can obviously remind you about something like Isaiah 41:10.
Yeah. Yeah, that's amazing. Gosh, I love that. And was it after you heard that from the Lord, later did you realize that that was basically Isaiah 41:10 that God was speaking to you?
No, but it... how can I say this? It was almost ringing in my ears.
Yeah.
Hey, this, you've read this before, Stephen. You know where this is.
Yeah.
And it didn't take long to find it. And the important thing is, for 35 years, I've never been afraid of this disease.
Wow.
Ever.
Wow.
God took it.
Yeah, one word from God.
Yeah, all I had to do was believe and trust him.
Yeah, that's amazing. Hey, I wanna ask you one more thing, if you don't mind, as we're ending.
No, I mind a lot, unless it's good.
well, you can let me know.
okay.
What would you say is a key that you've learned to staying steady with Jesus for the long haul? Just as life is unpredictable, as life can be very difficult. I mean, I know your story, and I know that you've gone through a lot of other hard things, you know, besides that.
Yeah.
And you've gone through a lot. And, what's something that you've learned over the years? Like this helps me to continue to trust God and to keep my head up no matter what happens.
Prayer. I know that when we pray, that is being presented before the throne of God.
Yeah.
And he is anxious to hear from us, especially when we're in need. My wife and I pray together over almost anything that's important, because we believe that there's a greater strength, and it builds our courage.
Yeah.
It reminds us of our relationship with God, that he's ever present, that he never leaves our side. If you'd like, I have one other verse I'd like to share with you.
Yeah.
Let me look it up in my high-tech phone here. It's in John, which is my favorite book.
Mm.
And
Genesis, Isaiah, the runners-up, and John's your favorite.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, those are the big three. So it's in chapter 10, excuse me, beginning in verse 25, it says, "Jesus answered them, 'I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, these testify of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Sorry, it makes me emotional, but it's one of the most encouraging passages I've ever read in the Bible.
Yeah. Yeah, no one can snatch us out of his hand.
No one.
The shepherd's
and
hand.
And nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Come on. Do you think we could to pay you to read the whole Bible out loud for us? Do like a Steve McClain audio version of the Bible?
Do you have like a Hopalong Cassidy box full of candy?
Deal. Deal. Green suckers
and coffee. Yeah. A small amount of raw sugar and milk. Yeah.
For the entire Bible read aloud by Steve McClain. For sure.
Yeah.
That's a sweet deal.
Well, I got a lot of good parts when I was in theater.
Yeah.
And I was always the hero in my early days of stage theater.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I became an actor and, you know, did some other things.
Yeah.
And
that's where your dramatic side comes from. You did theater, okay.
Yeah. Well, I started early.
Okay.
Yeah. But now, as a what you call a silver hair or gray hair, you've taken me completely off course. I was going to run down a rabbit trail, and I'm afraid I'm lost.
Yeah, it's okay. Hey, unless it comes to you in the next 5 seconds.
What'd you ask? What did you ask me again?
Gosh, I don't remember either.
I feel better now.
Yeah, we're both just along for the ride, man. I've got more gray hair than you. I don't know.
But change this to the fun cast or the laughy cast.
No, that's good. We better wrap it up.
Okay.
Thank you, Steve. I appreciate you. I enjoy you, and I think this is really valuable.
I thank you, and I've always loved you, and your whole family. And you know this because I told you once, as you got older, junior high, maybe high school, my ambition was that you would marry my daughter.
Oh, my gosh.
But as it turns out, Jessica's a pretty good deal.
Yeah, she is.
You did all right.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Yeah, I could ditto all the things you said. Yeah, I married up. So, yeah. Love you, Steve. Thanks.
I love you.
Okay, we'll see you next time, Radiant.